God of gentle rains and warm sun, God who encourages growth. God of freedom, of liberation, of binding ropes being cut. God of exodus and exile and homecoming, God who calls us to leave where we are and come home. And so we praise you for the growth. We give thanks for the healing we have received. And amen. Welcome to First Baptist Church. We're so glad you have joined us for worship. If you are a guest with us, a special welcome to you. There are connect cards in the pew in front of you that if you would like more information about us or have more information about you, you can fill that out and allow us to be able to touch base with you this week and drop it in the offering baskets, which are around the room. We are not passing anything right now, so you picked up your own bulletin as you came in, and we're not passing the offering during the service, so that's where those are, and you can drop any announcements or prayer concerns or connect cards into those baskets on your way out, and a lot of that is just for COVID precautions. We have a lot of churchwide announcements we want you to be aware of. You can see them. Last week we announced that Mary Alice is retiring, and she will be playing her favorite hits throughout the month of August, and we will celebrate with a reception for her on the last Sunday of the month during the 10 o'clock hour. So make note of that. Come celebrate with her, with us, as she has been such a bulwark in terms of our choir, our organ. We're so blessed to be able to have had her for the last 13 years and love her and are celebrating this retirement with her. Now, I think that all that means is she's just going to move right behind me, right? Just about 4 feet to your left, Mary Alice, and you'll just sing in my ear from every week after that. It is taxing to play the organ and to do it so well for 13 years. We have all been blessed. So come celebrate on the 29th with us, and we will honor her legacy at First Baptist. We have another churchwide announcement that we want you to be aware of, and I've asked that Susan Shiflett come and bring this good news.
Good morning, everyone. I'm excited to give you great news. This is sort of like what the angels said to the shepherds. When Jesus was born, he said, "We've got great news for you." Well, that's what I've got for you all. If you were here last Sunday, you remember that Barrett said that our committee is excited to bring you a candidate for this associate position of spiritual growth, associate pastor of spiritual growth. We are excited about that, but before I tell you more about that, let me take you back to last December. As you were probably getting ready to put up your Christmas decorations, the search committee had its first meeting on December the 21st. And our committee is Steve Hallett, Misty Furr, Penny Christ, Sheila Goodberry, Gail Mann, Matt Grand Prix, myself, and Barrett. And we have met every other week since December the 21st. And over that time, we have had over 70 different recommendations, resumes, and interests in our position, even as far outreaching as South Africa. Our committee looked and evaluated our job description. We placed ads in the Cooperative Baptist Fellowship material and the Baptist General Assembly of Virginia. We sent our ad also to seminaries and to Baptist publications. We reviewed over 60 applications, and we read answers to many questions that we asked them, and they wrote their answers and sent them to us. And when we interviewed, questions were as simple as "What's your favorite movie?" to very deep theological questions that came from you know who. We also had many Zoom interviews, and then we did a lot of praying that God would send us just the right person. And now I'm excited to tell you, he has. Our candidate is a woman, and she's from the Atlanta area. She has her seminary degree is from Baptist Theological Seminary that was in Richmond, and she has served church in Richmond as well as in the Atlanta area. She is engaging, she is energetic, she is spiritual, she's creative, and she is relational. And all of us on our committee are thrilled that she is going to come here. She'll be coming to Waynesboro this Friday, pick her up at the airport, and then she's going to be on a whirlwind visit of our area. She'll be looking around different areas, trying to see where she wants to live. She'll also be meeting with the church staff, meeting our committee members, church leaders, children, youth, families, and most important, she'll be meeting you. So I want to invite you to next Saturday to come to the fellowship hall at 10 o'clock, where you will meet our candidate and listen to her faith journey. Get to meet her and see all the exciting things that she is going to bring to our church. We prayed a lot about God finding just the right person for us and to bring that person to us, and we feel that he did. So we are anxious for you to meet her next week. There will be a called business meeting at the end of the first service and at this service to vote for her. So I will see you next Saturday in the fellowship hall at 10 o'clock. Let me see you bob your heads, right? Right, good. See you next Saturday.
I can't say enough about the process that Susan has led us on for the last 9 months. It is not fun to be the chair of a search committee. It is hard work. It is a lot of detail to keep everyone organized, to be the one communicating on behalf of our church to so many different people. And I will tell you, Susan has set the bar ridiculously high for anyone who is in such a role in years to come. We could not have done this without her leadership, without her poise, without her grace, and just being a retired educator, she just gets things done. And so we are so grateful for Susan and her leadership. And with that being said, let us go to God together in prayer. Everlasting God, this time of worship is for you. We come with expectant hearts. Our minds are open. Our hearts are ready to experience your grace. In your son's name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Our scripture lesson today comes from Colossians chapter 2. And for the month of August, we're moving through each chapter of Colossians and finding the depth and richness of this tiny little book, but chock so full of so many wonderful thoughts, especially about Christ. So our text is starting in verse 9, reading through 15. For in him the whole fullness of deity dwells bodily, and you have come to fullness in him, who is the head of every ruler and authority. In him also you were circumcised with a spiritual circumcision, by putting off the body of the flesh in the circumcision of Christ. When you were buried with him in baptism, you were also raised with him through faith in the power of God, who raised him from the dead. And when you were dead in the trespasses, in the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made you alive together with him, when he forgave us all our trespasses, erasing the record that stood against us with its legal demands. He set this aside, nailing it to the cross. He disarmed the rulers and authorities and made a public example of them, triumphing over them in it. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray together. God of light, we confess that too often we go astray and we leave your light. We follow the dim lights of the world, of success or fortune, or just whatever grabs our attention at the moment. We follow the dim lights that call us to be more religious by following more rules. We follow the fading light of even personal salvation. Forgive us for not seeking the true light of your love for all the world. Forgive us for not following the ways of Jesus, who commanded us to love one another, who calls us to be light bearers of love and compassion and grace, in which the mystery of your love is revealed. It's in the name of Jesus the Christ and the light to all the world that we pray these things. Amen.
Trembling, the trumpet sounds within of my soul. I ain't got long to stay here.
The book of Colossians calls us to live a Christ-soaked life. We're taking the whole month to think about that one phrase, Christ-soaked. It's a good one. There's a lot of ways to think about it. Last week, we introduced the idea of a sponge, and that's a very good one. But there's a second image that's equally as compelling for me. It's somewhat of a synonym to sponge, too. And that's baptism, especially immersion, the way that we Baptists do it. Think about what baptism is and does. It's a covenant, an act between you and God, and it's you telling God you want to be Christ-like. It's you saying, I've seen enough in me. I don't want to do this like this anymore. I want to live like Christ. I want to die to my old self, which is often why we go backwards into the water. I want to wash the sins of old clean, which is why we use water. And I want to rise again in new life, which is when we emerge soaked from head to toe. I mean, you could say that baptism is the ceremonial act of becoming Christ-soaked. But baptism doesn't mark the beginning of your faith. As Baptists, we use a phrase called believer's baptism. I mean, think about that one. You have to be a believer before you can be baptized. So if I talk to someone prior to being baptized, I often pray with them to accept Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior into their life or into their heart. Some call this praying the sinner's prayer, and that's fine. For me, it's about inviting Christ into who you are. I'm telling you all of this because of what we just read in Colossians 2. The author is writing to entice this church community to go all in, to be Christ as best as you can imitate. And then he starts grabbing metaphors to help explain what he's talking about. So I want to look at these verses again. It may be helpful for you to follow along, starting in verse 9. For in him the whole fullness of deity dwells bodily, and you have come to fullness in him, who is the head of every ruler and authority. So out of the gate, the author re-emphasizes what we learned last week in chapter 1. Christ is the fullness of God, all of creation, all of everything dwells bodily in Christ. And when we come to the fullness of God too, we can tap in to that Christ-ness. We can access the divine. But how? Verse 12. When you were buried with him in baptism, you were also raised with him through faith in the power of God, who raised him from the dead. Now keep in mind, this is all metaphor, but it's a powerful one. How do we access the divine and become Christ-soaked? We bury ourselves and get baptized and become raised again in the faith and power of God. Baptism soaks us in the power of God. And we're not talking about real water here. And that's what makes this such a rich metaphor. To be Christ-soaked is to go all in, all the way under. And we take on the fullness of how the deity dwells. And our bodies become Christ-soaked, which gives us access to the divine. I just love this. It's such a provocative thought. Look at verses 13 and 14. And when you were dead in trespasses and uncircumcision of the flesh, God made you alive together with him, who forgave us all our trespasses, erasing the record that stood against us with its legal demands. He set this aside, nailing it to the cross. Well, now the author adds a second and third metaphor here. We were dead in sin, our flesh was dead too. But baptism allows us to be spiritually circumcised. There is no good way to talk about circumcision without talking about circumcision. So I'll let you Google it and wrestle with that on your own. It is exactly what you think. But I will say this. Essentially, and somewhat grotesquely, the writer is saying that we need to cut off the parts of our body that represent the sinful, worldly things. But he's not saying do that literally. it's a metaphor. And what remains is the fullness of how the deity dwells and moves and lives among us and makes us what was dead alive. And then a third metaphor is he jumps us into a courtroom. Becoming Christ-soaked erases our past mistakes, exonerates us like as if we were in court. And how does this happen? You read the last half of verse 14. He set these things aside, nailing them to the cross. So, Christ gives us the ability to become Christ-like. We take on that privilege through an act of baptism, which is a symbolic moment that we declare to the world that we want to be a place where the fullness of the deity of God dwells. And this is just another beautiful way to say we should live a life that is Christ-soaked. Colossians is so rich to me. Everything we do, the actions we take, the thoughts we think, the friendships we maintain, the way we spend our money, the way we spend our time, what we give our attention to and our minds, it all gets infused and baptized and saturated with Christ. We get to live in and for Christ. Making the way around college campuses is an article, and a lot of college students are reading this. It's written by the late Stephen Kreitz. He was a former professor at Yale Divinity. The article that all the college students are reading right now, it's called this, The Narrative Quality of Experience. It is seminal work in the study of narrativity. And I know it sounds incredibly boring, but it is anything but. What Dr. Kreitz argues is that our experiences shape our understanding of faith. To prove his point, Kreitz uses an illustration. Imagine two circles or two spheres that are one's on top of the other. Just two circles that aren't touching. The bottom circle represents our worldly life and what he calls the mundane. The top circle represents what he calls the sacred. So if you were to draw them, you would draw them where they don't touch. The mundane, it sits under the sacred. It desperately wants to encounter the sacred, but it'll never be able to on its own. But luckily, every once in a while, the sacred comes down to the mundane. Kreitz says that our experiences are always trapped in the mundane. Nothing we do can allow us to escape into the sacred on our own. But occasionally, the sacred comes to us. And we experience something not of this world, and we are forever changed by it. Baptism is a sacred encounter. If you go back in your mind, think about the rolling waters when you gave your life to Christ, the feeling, the experience, the hope. You woke up that morning in a world that was full of mundane things, but at some point that morning, heaven came to you, and you emerged from the baptismal waters feeling an awe-shaking reality that the sacred is now with you, and you are changed because of it. And just like when Jesus was baptized, when you came up out of the water, the sacred heavens opened and God entered into your mundane reality and whispered the same thing that was said to Jesus. You are my beloved. In you, I am well pleased. When you gave your life over to Christ, your soul heard these words. And whether you realize it consciously or not, the sacred had entered into you. And it is still telling you, you are my beloved. Go, be blessed. Ironically, though, we fail to hear this. We don't know how to receive this from God because a lot of times our minds and our hearts are trapped in the mundane. One of my favorite theologians is Henry Nouwen, and he says this: the feeling of being blessed is not a feeling we generally have about ourselves. We've lived many hard moments in life, moments in which we felt more cursed than blessed. And I can say the same. In fact, I suspect that many of us suffer from a deep sense of being cursed. That's his quote. From time to time, Nouwen's words have haunted me because they're so true for all of us. I have felt victim to a world that I cannot change, and you probably have too. It's much easier to claim the negativity of life and declare that we are cursed or the world is cursed than it is to claim a belovedness from the sacred. There are seasons in life where, for whatever reason, a lot of us just choose to be miserable. We choose to feel cursed. And when this happens, we can be rest assured that we have been lost in the land of the mundane. And that's why we need the sacred. That's why we need reminding of things like our baptism. These memories remind us that we're not wretched, we're not broken or gross or dark souls trapped in the world. We are more. We may struggle. We may fail. We may hurt, and at times we may break. But that's the moment the sacred bursts in, and we're reminded that the curse that we have felt is never the final act, because we are also blessed. We are also beloved as we are, for who we are, because we have become Christ-soaked. So here's something I think the author of Colossians would agree with, and would probably even say if we're alive today. There's nothing you can do to make God love you more. And there is absolutely nothing you can do to make God love you less. You have become Christ-soaked. The old has been circumcised, washed away, born new. Whatever metaphor works for you, use it, because you aren't cursed, you're blessed. Christ has erased the record that stood against you with its legal demands. He set it aside, nailing it to the cross. He allowed you to be spiritually circumcised so you could then be the body for which the heavenly deity dwells. I just love that. And this is another beautiful reason why we should be, and why we should continue to be and to live a Christ-soaked life. Receive this benediction. Depart now in peace, knowing the God of all creation is loving, gracing, and redeeming you still.